So we're going to the Oval, 2-1 up, Ashes there to be won, or one kind of hand on the Ashes. Did you get a sense at this point of how big this story was for the entire country?
Front page, back page.
Middle pages.
Everywhere. Yeah. Every newspaper you picked up, you couldn't get away from it. And one of the things that really annoyed me about going into the week is the news about the open-top bus that had been prepped and ready to go, and almost then on all the newspapers and stuff that was being put around.
So it was a bit premature.
You just knew that it was going to come back to bite us, and we're out in the middle, that we were going to get some chew-up about it or whatever it's going to be, and you knew that somewhere down the line this could really bite you. Because it almost took the focus away from the preparation and what we had to try and do. You know, you're starting to worry about something else, knowing you've got to play a massive test match still and going back for your life.
But also that could motivate the Aussies as well, you know. They don't need any more motivating when it comes to the Ashes. And to see that in the papers, you're just thinking, what is going on here?
From being from up in the northeast, Durham were only, first class county from 92. So cricket's not, you know, the big thing, it's football. You go to my local cricket club on a Saturday morning, and there's maybe 40, 50 kids. All of a sudden, during that 7-8 weeks and after that, 250 kids there. Yeah, so we changed. And I'm not a rugby fan, but when Johnny Wilkinson drop-kicked that ball, 2003, how much the country changed. And I think you could have gotten a bit ahead of yourself thinking, at the start of the week, this is where we could be after like what the rugby lads were. And I think that could have been, that could have took your mind off what was happening. But fortunately, it didn't.
Is that the moment or what? Most extraordinary. That is a certain chance gone.
The Shane Warne drop. I mean, it was a cruel thing in a way because he really showed his greatness as a cricketer.
He did.
In that series.
But then KP went on to show how great a cricketer he was and how he didn't care who was bowling. And Brett Lee was bowling. I can remember, I think Brett Lee bowled quicker in that game at me than any other game that I played.
I mean, the context, lunchtime on that final day now, I suppose. I mean, the game is very much in the balance there before the KP Brett Lee showed it.
And KP kept on hooking him. I've got absolutely no idea how you get into a position to hook somebody that's bowling at nearly 100 mile an hour. And he kept on top edging. I can remember Tate shelling one on the boundary, and he kept on cloughing one, and then he'll middle one, it went out of the park, and the atmosphere and the electricity was just so vibrant.
And in the dressing room, were you guys happy to see him keep playing?
I wasn't watching. As I said, I was in the back room.
I was sat in the little spot where Alex Stewart used to change, and I was just playing with a rugby ball there. I couldn't watch. I couldn't watch live.
The telly was up there.
I was just watching. You know, just trying to just keep an eye on it, and it's kept going for four, and you listen to the roars that come through the doorways and stuff, not quite knowing what's really happening, and just thinking, please just carry on batting as long as you can.
And with hindsight, watching KP throughout his years and playing with him, you always knew when he was getting a little bit bored, and you had to tell the next, get ready, because it's either going to be something special or he's going to be out in the next 10 overs. But that game, he's sort of, right, I'm taking it to them, and thankfully he had a day.
But I think what helped there as well was Vaughan's attitude, wasn't it?
Yeah,
he's wanted you got there and expressed yourself. He said, lads, don't worry about it. You're in this team for a reason.
It's interesting, because I spoke to him after that series, an interview for the paper or something, and he told me that the night before the game, or one of the nights of the game, he threw up. He was that kind of worried and nervous. But obviously, he didn't show that. I mean,
no. His glasses helped. Because you couldn't see his eyes. So no matter what, you know, you can tell by somebody's eyes, can't you, if they're nervous or not. He never had his glasses, you know, to the general public or to the outside perception. Michael's eyes were always covered, so even if he was nervous inside and he was feeling it, he'd never let on, which was a great trait for him.
And you can always see when, if it was going bad or you bowled a bad ball, there was no emotion or anything, but when things went well, you could see he was more excited than anybody and punching the air. And there's a picture over there with him jumping on your back celebrating a wicket, and his over sort of like celebration was most probably his release of saying, yes, we've gone somewhere, something's going right, and then being able to block out the emotion when something was going not in the way that he wanted it to.
And a bit of rain didn't go amiss.
No, it was always nice.
When they came out with their sunglasses, I remember that. Bad light. They all came out with
There was two parts of the crowd, wasn't there? There was the English crowd and the Australian crowd. And every time it started raining, the English crowd went up and the Australian crowd got the sunglasses out. And every time it stopped raining, the English crowd got the umbrellas out. And
Eventually, right at the end, the umpires had to walk out, didn't they, and ceremoniously take the bales off to signal the end. Where were you guys at this stage?
We were already celebrating. We've been told it was all done.
That was a disgrace for me. I thought that was the biggest cheat to the British public or the English.
The way it ended.
Yeah, because we found out 2 minutes before that in the dressing room. Vaughan goes in the umpire's room, comes in, and we all know it's finished. We're all in this big huddle in the changing room, ready to go berserk. We've just won the Ashes, first time in 20-odd years. That huddle should have been in front of 25,000 people because. What we had given ourselves and put ourselves through as a group of 12, they had gone with us. That really gave me a bit of taste, the way the umpires effectively wanted their little bit of fame of knocking the bill.
I wasn't worried.
No.
I didn't bother me.
No, I was more than happy to celebrate.
You were two bottles in.
I think we'd all
stage.
Loved to have been out. If it had been out on the middle of the oval, it would have been fantastic. But that's, you're talking, dreams are... what it's all about, to win that great series, but then to celebrate in front of them would have been amazing, of course, but we still...
The lack of honours and
everything else that came after it was still...
It was an incredible scene, actually, just before the presentation of the Ashes, when you did the lap of honour and Jerusalem was playing and the Union Jacks were flying or the Cross of St George. I mean, it was an incredible scene.
Wish you could do it all again, because it gets wrapped up so quick and you know, there's so much emotion going through everything that you just wish you could relive.
And soak it in a bit more.
Yeah, because it's you're buzzing, you're enjoying what's going on, but it's over so fast.
I think I'd say that career-wise as well. I had 17 years professional cricketer, 18 years professional cricketer, and it went like that. And, I've spoke to my wife about it quite a bit in the last sort of 2 years, and we didn't appreciate it. Four kids, but... we had kids as well. We toured Australia, toured the Caribbean and things like that. And I don't think you appreciate it at the time, what you're actually doing and what you've got and what you've been given. And, that day for me was one of the best days of my life. To go through the West Indies, to go through 7 test matches at home, to go through South Africa, to then be on the field with 12 blokes who have gone through the whole thing with you, and seeing what the noise was in the Jerusalem, I think that was pretty special. I think that'll take some beating.